Jesus, my heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. Thank you.
but like every fiber of our being, like while we're at school and at home, whenever fear comes, whenever things get really hard, when you're really sad, really angry, we take it to you. Whenever we're getting attacked, we hear those voices, and they just pound us, they beat us, they throw us on the ground and kick us. Like, you silence those boasts. There's no condemnation for those who are in Jesus. There's no condemnation. There's no accusation. No kicking while you're down. We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. So thank you, Jesus. It's crazy. It's crazy. So help us live in that reality more and more. Jesus. Amen.
Yay, thank you.
All right, grab a seat. Man, thank you, Brian and the gang. That, wish we could do this every day, worship together. That would be awesome. Okay, so what we're going to do next is we are going to split. We're going to dismiss 7th and 8th grade. You know your room to go to. 9th through 12th grade, staying here. However, we communicated this to your parents, 7th and 8th grade, in high school. Thank you, Brian. In high school, we're going to cover the topic of self-harm. So we told middle school parents that we were going to just let that be a choice. 7th and 8th graders, if you want to stay in here, you're more than welcome to. If you want to continue and go with Brian and the gang over to middle school, we're going to actually let it be your option, which I've never done in my time of being here. Have we left that option open for 7th and 8th grade? So when we take a 30-second break, if you're like, you know what, I'm going to go with Brian and continue in the study that you guys are in, you have the freedom to do it. If you're a 7th and 8th grader and you're like, you know what, I'm going to stick around and I want to hear about that, you can stay. We're just going to let you be led by the Spirit in that. Is that clear direction, or 7th and 8th grade, do you feel confused by that? Thank you, Scott. Yeah. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. I didn't consider that. I'll let you also be led by the Spirit. The Spirit never gets it wrong. I'll just leave it to the Spirit. Thank you. That's called poor leadership. I didn't think of that. Thank you, Sarah, for that great question. Elizabeth, what do you think? Attagirl. Thank you. All right, join. Hey, so let's just take a 45-second break, and then we're going to jump into it. We good? Everyone throw up the AOK? Okay, 45-second break, go. Thank you. Okay. How are you, Sarah Pierce? Can I have a card? Okay, so I'm just going to pray for us real quick, and then I'm going to talk for 2-3 minutes. I'm going to introduce my friend, give her the mic, and then we'll be blessed with what the Spirit has to say through Lynn. But real quick, pray with me. God, I just want to thank you for bringing us all together in your sovereignty. Even before we were born, even before you made the world, you knew who was going to be in this room at this time in 2018 to hear the words of your Spirit spoken through your people. So I just want to praise you for your majesty and your powerfulness. And just, you're so mighty. And I just love that you are that kind of God. I just want to adore you for that. And I'm so thankful that you are our God. God, for several of us, I pray that maybe that don't claim you as their God, that tonight would be the night that they would cry out for salvation and say, God, you are my God. Or maybe for several that have gone astray, God, by the kindness and your gentle spirit, would you draw them back? God, for so many of us, we're in so many different worlds and with this topic of self-harm. And so God, we want to be a youth group that doesn't run from hard topics, but that we embrace them. But first and foremost, we run to your word. To be the final say in anything and everything and any topic. And God, would you give me and Lynn a lot of grace? Would you give our life group leaders grace as we go to group and just process it a little bit more? So God, we just want to be a youth group that honors you with easy, mild, and hard things and everything. So we just want to commit this time to you. And we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. So it was probably about 6 months ago, I got a letter. And if you guys didn't know this, right outside of our hallway right here, there's a big, bright yellow mailbox. And right above it, it just says, hey, any comments, requests, prayer requests, concerns, whatever, write it, drop it in here, and we want to hear from you. And so many of you have taken us up on that. But one night after youth group, I got this letter, and I read it, and it just took my breath away. And I've read it before to some of you, but maybe not all of us have heard this, but it kind of got me moving in a direction of concern, but a good concern. So much so that we even held a special leader meeting to get more training on the topic of self-harm. And then, obviously, it brought us to tonight where we wanted to talk about it. But this is what the letter said, and I want to read it before introducing Lynn. It just says, hi, Tim. I wrote this anonymous letter because I wanted you to be aware of something and maybe be willing to preach at a live on it before we start back this summer. Sorry. It's December. I was wondering if you could preach on self-harm. Self-harm is a part of many of your students at Alive. I know a senior that just graduated from youth group who still deals with self-harm. I don't know how to help him other than to let him know that he is loved. I know many of your students that cut are crying for help. It is easy to hide your self-harm, so it can be hard for you to see that it's a part of your youth group. Cutting to the person is for relief, for coping, but sometimes it isn't. Cutting can cause or be because of suicidal thoughts. I know many, many of your students that would benefit from this topic being preached. I have thought and prayed about it, and God is telling me to ask you to preach it and preach it soon. Please think about this. This was a hard letter for me to write, but I'm putting it in God's hands. So that was something I got and thought, okay, Lord, like maybe you're doing something here. I want to listen to your spirit. First thing we did was kind of train the leaders, and then it brought us to this tonight. And this is Lynn Adams. Lynn is on staff at North Hills Church. She's in our counseling department. And Lynn has been used in our church in such a mighty way. She probably hates me for even putting the spotlight on her, but I want to. I want to honor you because we love you so much. And if you don't know Lynn, get to know Lynn. God has used her in a mighty way in my marriage with meeting with Rachel and in other people in our church and in our community. So when I thought, man, how can I bless this the Alive student ministry body? And the first person I thought of was Lynn. And I went into Lynn's office, and Lynn was just so humble and listening. It was so gracious to say, yeah, I'll come, absolutely. So one of the ideas that you had was for us to kind of throw it out to you and say, hey, if you have any questions or anything you want us to cover, go back to that mailbox and drop it in. And you guys definitely took advantage of that. I remember emailing you those questions and you emailed back just how thankful you were and how happy you were about those questions. So what I would love to do is just give the mic to Lynn and then kind of set you up with kind of covering the topic as a whole. And then maybe covering some of those questions that stood out. But we have until 8 o'clock, so we've got 25 minutes with Lynn Adams, which I'm so excited. And we want to leave a few minutes at the end for you guys, if you have any remaining questions or anything maybe that you also want to see covered or talked about. If we have time, we would love to do that. We good? Cool. Can we give a little golf clap round of applause for Lynn Adams?
I'm not used to talking with the mic, so I might just yell or whatever. Are you guys allowed to have cell phones in here? Or do you have a basket out there where you dump them? Or do you have to have your cell phone?
If I took their cell phones, we'd have a meeting.
So, everybody take out your cell phone. And all you have to do is text the word connect to 741-741. That's it. It's also easy to remember. So if you have a friend that is struggling with self-harm, anybody can text this number. If you're trying to help someone, you could text and say, hey, I'm with my friend and I don't know what to tell them. That's the right help too. So I wanted to do that right out of the gate because I thought it would be cool for you guys to have a tool right away. Virtually everybody has a phone, not everybody does. And now you have something you can share and something you can do and a way that you can actually proactively move to get unhooked from this difficult habit if you're struggling. So, okay. So it's text connect, C-O-N-N-E-C-T, to 741-741. Okay. Hey. And hopefully the leaders all got that too, because that's potentially pretty useful. So self-harm, I've been around kids since about 1992. I was a high school counselor for almost 10 years at Wayhampton High School. Anybody here go to Wayhampton? A few brave people go to Wayhampton. So most people graduate in 4 years, it took me 10. But I learned a lot there about self-harm and about just about the kinds of things that kids struggle with that leads to that behavior. But there's been a ton of research since then. In the last 20 years, a lot of research has exposed things that we thought, 30 years ago that, essentially isn't true now, they've discovered. One of the things they discovered is that self-harm doesn't mean that you're suicidal. That's an interesting thing. A lot of people think that if someone is cutting, that they actually don't want to live anymore. So two things are true about that. One is that self-harm usually has nothing to do with suicidal thoughts, but sometimes, actually, cutting is a way to keep under control the deeper despair and suicidal thoughts that a person has. So that's why it's important to pay attention. inserting objects into the skin, purposely bruising or breaking one's bones, one's own bones, and certain forms of hair pulling. Hair pulling, I want to say, falls into a couple different categories. Where's my friend Cheryl? I wanted to say too to you guys that if you have questions about anything I'm saying tonight, Cheryl is here every single week, and she's got the answers. She can help you, or she can direct you to someone who will be able to help you. So I'm about to tell you a couple things about self-harm that are interesting and different. And if you're afraid that you have one of these things, then talk to Cheryl, because I know she can help you. So self-harm, it can be reflected in hair pulling, but usually hair pulling is something else. I'm going to let her tell you that. If you struggle with hair pulling, it's an interesting phenomenon. And people like me who are counselors do come across it periodically. But self-harm is also often connected to some of these things: eating disorders, depression, anxiety disorders, substance abuse, including alcohol or nicotine, and conduct or oppositional defiant disorders. And that's, again, something you can talk to Cheryl about. So if you struggle with self-harm, it doesn't mean that you have one of these other issues, but it does mean that you may actually potentially in the future struggle with one of those things, particularly an addictive behavior like substance abuse. In fact, I'm going to get into that in a second, but self-harm is a form of substance abuse. And a lot of people look at me like, oh, really? But it is. Self-harm can become an addiction to your own biochemical response to pain. So I'm going to answer a couple of these questions in that context, because it's kind of scary to think that you can actually do something to yourself that you then can become addicted to that involves pain. Before I do that, I want to say that I want to say something that self-harm is, and then I want to say what it usually isn't, not always. So self-harm is almost always an expression of emotional pain, almost always. There's pain somewhere in the history, in the heart, in the soul of the person who's experiencing self-harm. But something has happened, or something is happening, that makes them feel like they can't talk about it, they can't express that, and they could be shamed emotionally, there could be many reasons. But emotional pain is almost always at the heart of self-harm. It usually isn't a cry for attention. Sometimes it is. And that's kind of weird to say, it usually isn't, but sometimes it is. And it's hard to tell unless you really get to know the person, talk to them, and hear them out. So listening to a person and hearing their heart about whatever they're struggling with is really important to understand where they're coming from. That even in the heart of a person who's experiencing a need, or they have a desire just to get attention, there's an underlying something emotionally that's painful. So you guys asked really good questions. I was just blown away, really encouraged. I'm just going to read a couple of these and talk through them because I feel like they're important. And some of the questions you asked, I felt like expressed the heart of a lot of people. So can I explain why a person that self-harms thinks it helps in the moment? So this is going to be weird, and please tell your parents I was not like promoting self-harm when I say this, but when a person self-harms, there's an experience that is biological in nature, that actually does feel like a rush, like a soothing thing, because there are all these endorphins that are released and other neurotransmitters that tell the body that the body's in trouble, but then and calm the body down, and that can be kind of a temporary, momentary comfort or bring some relief. But it doesn't last, and then the pain resumes, the emotional pain resumes. So it doesn't fix anything, but there is just a momentary relief. So the next question is, how is self-harm or cutting a coping skill? That's basically it. It's a desire for relief. It's an attempt to experience that essentially chemical high from your brain chemistry. And the same person asked, is it a toxic coping skill? Actually, yes it is, because you can become dependent on self-harm as a way to cope because of the chemistry involved. Just like you can become dependent on just about anything. So repeated self-harm can trigger that physically addictive pattern. So if you associate self-harm and the very tiny relief that comes from that with a particular emotional pain or struggle or something, then every time that happens, the desire to self-harm will rise up. You'll experience that. Just like alcoholics who drink to numb the pain of an emotional breakup or whatever, every time they experience those hard emotions, they're going to drink because they associate those two things. So self-harm can be both physiologically addicting, and it also can be emotionally or psychologically addicting too. So that was the next question. Can it be addictive? Well, yes, absolutely it can be. So what does God say about self-harm? The Bible doesn't say a whole lot about self-harm, except my pages are out of order.
Small commercial while she's trying to find that. She's going to answer and walk through next. Life Group Leaders, I think this would be a really good thing to kind of hone in on and kind of maybe really hit on in a bigger way when we break up into our groups. A small commercial. And now back to Lynn.
You don't know what I'm about to say, but I don't know.
To be continued.
So the Bible doesn't say a lot about self-harm, but what it does say isn't very good, I guess is the way to put that. There are several references to cutting or self-harm in Scripture. One of those is a reference in 1 Kings 18, where they're actually talking about false religions, the worship of Baal. That was an active practice for people who worshipped other gods besides Yahweh. It also was a practice that people engaged in when they were mourning for the dead. And it was forbidden by God in Leviticus. And then the fourth example or mention is the demon-possessed man in Mark 5 was actually engaged in cutting before Jesus healed him. And it was remarkable enough that it was recorded in Scripture. So that doesn't mean that if you're cutting, you're demon-possessed. But it does suggest, not just that, but this whole picture does suggest that it's a dark practice that doesn't include worship of God, the one we just sang about. It doesn't embrace our place as his creation and those who he's called to himself. So when you're engaging in self-harm and you're trying to solve a problem, that emotional pain problem, God usually isn't really active in the picture. In other words, you're not pursuing his answer for the struggle that you're experiencing. So self-harm is intensely self-focused. It's very internally focused. And when a person is engaged in self-harm, they're typically trying to solve a problem on their own. They're experiencing some kind of horrible shame. Self-harm also happens, or it coincides often with people who've been sexually abused or experienced some other form of abuse, because there's a lot of shame involved in that. So what do you do when you're experiencing that kind of shame? Or you're formerly a cutter and you don't want to be anymore and you're tempted to cut. Prayer, I think, is your most powerful tool. You pray with someone. Pray with someone who cares for you. Pray that God will change your circumstances, because usually circumstances are the external pressure that is producing the stress and tension. Pray that God would give you courage and strength to endure whatever it is that's going on at the time. That's what he promises. He's our strength for us when we're weak. And pray that God would give you different desires in your heart. One of the questions that someone asked is, how do I stop cutting or self-harm? When I feel a relapse coming, or I'm relapsing, I'm just at the beginning of that. And that's exactly what you need to do. Ask for help. Talk to someone who actually can help you. Teachers and guidance counselors can be very helpful. Cheryl, again, is qualified and trained to help. You can come and talk to me. Talk to your life group leaders. They've had some training. Ask for help if you feel that urge. That urge coming on. So go with them, just like I would tell kids, if your friend tells you they want to kill themselves, you break that promise when they say don't tell anybody. You break this promise too. Just come on, let's go together. I'll go with you. I'll do all the talking. It's okay. It's okay to do that. I'm telling you guys, it's okay. And that may be the best thing you can do for someone that you know. So how does God help? precious is their blood, you have said. So if you're struggling with self-harm, I would encourage you to go to Psalm 72, 12 through 14, and meditate on that, and ask God to show you how valuable you are to Him, the God of the universe, and He will hear you.
So Psalm 72 is kind of a great place to hang out. Where was it that your fearfully and wonderfully made passage in Psalms that you were sharing? 139. I think Psalm 139 is a real another great passage to hang out in and hear what God thinks about you and how He's made you. All of that stuff as we process this. So let's just end with, Sarah, I know you just cut your hand in the mirror, but is there any question or maybe a comment or anything that we as a family want to bring to the table to discuss more on this?
So my question was, are there any signifiers that you can think of besides outright scars that tell you of self-harming, and how would you approach that situation?
That's a really good question. And
what was the question? Y'all hear that? So if you're a middle schooler and you were in here, Borsik, Caleb, and Mary are going to stay up here and process this with middle schoolers in here. Is there a group that meets in the high school?
No.
Perfect. It's all yours, Mary and Caleb. Anything else? Hey guys, I want you to know we don't want to bleed in the life group, but we want this to be a safe place for you. You will not be looked at different. You won't be thought of different. You won't be judged or shunned or any of that. This is a place where, if you don't feel safe to talk about it here, where can you? We want this to be the place where if you're dealing with this or thinking about it or processing it, do all of that with us. Do all that with Lynn and Cheryl, your life group leaders, with me. Do it with us. And that's why I was with a couple of youth pastors getting lunch the other day, and they were asking us how we were starting our Christmas series, and I'm like, bold. Yeah, but that's what we're doing, because we feel real led by the Spirit, and it's not real holly jolly-ish, but we want you guys to really take us up on that. Take your life group leaders up on that. Brittany, yeah.
I just wanted to suggest looking at 1 Corinthians 10 also, because it's a passage that talks about, it says, therefore, let anyone who thinks that he stands take heed lest he fall, and no temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability, but with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure it. And I think that's just important based off of everything you just said with the whole shame and not wanting to talk to someone. I think that's just an important thing to remember.
Is that verse 13?
Yeah.
1 Corinthians 10, 13?
12 through 13, yeah.
Good. Thank you.
I know your parents all saved you. You can tell us everything. You can say anything to us and whatever, X, Y, and Z. But I'm telling you, we're not your parents. So you really can. You really can tell us anything. You can tell your life group leaders anything. You can tell me anything. You can tell Cheryl anything. You really can. So you have somebody who can do that, and they're not going to give you restrictions. They're not going to take your phone from you. They're not going to freak out. They're going to love you, and they're going to walk through.
Okay, we have time for one more, if there is. Cheryl, will you stand up? So Cheryl Childers oversees our one-on-one mentor team. Yeah.
Cheryl is a licensed professional social worker. She's a licensed social worker. So she actually has a practice, and she's better than me. She's amazing. I love her. And she meets with people for a living, and she loves kids. That's why she's here with you guys every Sunday night. So you can ask her anything.
Last. Yeah, well, I'm with you. Yes, sir.
30 seconds, just a victory story. My brother struggled with this. And it almost cost him his career. However, the Lord graciously allowed him, he's a police officer now, it's all he wanted to do to serve others. But he didn't share anything because he couldn't be positive. And devastated my parents. And almost cost him his career. God is good, and he's good now, and he's a police officer, and I know he's doing really well. So, you can beat this if this is true. So, thanks for coming.
Good. Love you, Les. Thank you for that. Hey, we love you guys. Please go to group, process this together, talk, be open. We do life groups to give you a place to do this together. Alive, are we good? Can we thank Lynn for being with us? All for you. May freedom reign. God, your word says that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom and there's liberty. So we claim that promise because we know your Spirit's here. So be with us as we go to groups. Be with us as we go to school. Help us to take one big thing from this. One big thing. And then we do it to your glory. And all God's people said, amen. Love you guys. Thank you.